I'll say, yeah, that sounds good. When do you think we'll get that? Oh, what the hell?
Yeah, trying to sound cool. I see you. I say y'all now too for some reason. It was never part of my vernacular, and then I started saying howdy as well. Almost.
I don't think you can help it. Where do you say you live again?
I live in Chicago. At no point have I lived in a place where people say howdy normally.
Or y'all. Y'all is very easy though. I mean, it's very convenient. You can take two words, turn it into one.
Oh yeah, just that slippery tongue. Okay, yeah. So I just went live on the Facebook. I hope that's cool. I figured, this is a good time for us to get started. And thank you again for joining. I know you're really busy this time of year, David. You're an agent and all that, but I figured I'd introduce David. He is the co-host of the Bigger Pockets podcast, which a lot of you listen to. He's the author of Buy, Rehab, Rent, Refinance, Repeat, the book on Burr, and the author of The Long Distance Real Estate Investing, How to Buy, Rehab, and Manage Out-of-State Rental Property. He's also an award-winning California real estate agent, has a mastermind group of his own. He also owns single-family, multifamily, and commercial properties and does notes and flips houses as well. So with all his skills and experience and strategies, he's trying to help teach people how to build their own portfolio just like his. Without further ado, I gave kind of a bio, but if you want to talk a bit more about what you do, David, I figured it'd be really good to sort of get your, how you got to be where you are.
See, Nelson, you're smart because you said without further ado, which is what Brandon says on the podcast every week. And now you're making me feel like I'm at home. So you're going to get a much better interview now. You've made me feel comfortable. Yeah, you mostly hit it. I mean, what you just described about me was what I like to consider, as of this moment, this is the first time I had this thought, but kind of the first iteration of my real estate journey was becoming an investor, buy and hold, flipping houses, note investing, the Burr method, and building wealth that way. Now in the second journey, I've kind of moved into selling houses as a real estate agent, building a team, and now I'm starting building a mortgage business. So I went from learning how to be an investor, which is kind of backwards from what most people do, to learning how to be a businessman. So a lot of what I'm learning now are business principles, models, systems, people skills, how to get people to work for me, how to teach stuff, how to learn new industries. So that's where most of my time is spent right now. And I'm taking all the information that I learned about building wealth for myself, and I'm using it to help my clients. So I help them build wealth through real estate. And then I had to learn the mortgage industry because I wanted to save them money on their loans. I had to learn, how to sell houses at a high level to get them more money so they could go reinvest it into other stuff. So the next books I'm working on right now for Bigger Pockets are about how to be a top producing real estate agent, because if we're honest, most agents suck and we all know it, and they don't get very good training. So I'm trying to write a resource that agents don't have an excuse to suck. And I'm happy to talk with you about anything you want for any of the stuff I'm doing.
Perfect. Okay. A lot of people in this group, they're out of state, East, West Coast people who can't afford their own neighborhoods. Frankly, you wrote also the book on how to invest out of state. What would you recommend for somebody starting out who is trying to find a partner and vet them, but in this period of time, a lot of stuff has changed, right? So it's like, I know you wrote the book a while ago, but what would you recommend today? Has your advice going to change, or where do you think it's going to go in the future for people trying to invest out of state?
No, I think out of state investing is going to become more and more prominent. I think the book I wrote opened people's eyes to the fact that it's easier to do than what they thought. Maybe not even easier to do. Maybe a better way to say is it's less risky than what there was this really big misconception that I was raised to hear, that out of state investing is the same as gambling. You're just throwing a dart and you're hoping it lands somewhere good. And no one had really reconsidered that after technology, but technology changed the world to the point that you have all the same resources available to you on the internet that you would if you lived there. And I think COVID-19 has kind of only helped make that point even more clear, right? Now I'm selling houses to people, giving presentations on Zoom and looking up numbers on the internet and having phone calls and calls like this without even actually meeting them in person and sitting down, right? Information is available, and how you communicate that information is incredibly important. But the actual proximity of where you are, I think, is becoming less important. So we'll see certain things like maybe certain areas become less in demand. There was a time where people wanted to live close to work, and certain industries you can work from home. So that's not as important, but the location is always going to matter, right? The weather is going to matter, the amenities, what restaurants are nearby, stuff like that. So I think real estate investing out of state is going to become more popular. I think we've seen a bit of a slowdown lately just because so many people have done it. There's a lot more people getting into buying real estate in general. The economy is doing relatively well, really well for all things considered, which gives everybody the confidence to go invest in real estate. So I had this huge advantage where I was this California guy with California money pushing people around in the South. And now everyone's doing that. There's New York money down there doing the same thing. So yeah. I think that there's people that were like jumped in 3, 4, 5 years ago that were, it was awesome. Now it's a little bit tougher because there's more competition. I don't think out of state investing is going away though. I think it's actually going to become easier to do, which will make the deals harder to find.
So would you recommend, is it still good enough for people to go into like the tertiary or secondary markets now? Or do you think that's where, as people say, late in like a cycle? So
that's a good point. Here's just what Nelson's saying, how to understand real estate in general. I'm going to use the Bay Area market because that's where I live. And it's very easy to make this point with the Bay Area market, but it would apply to any metro. You could pick Denver, you could pick Austin, you could pick New York, you could pick Miami. Okay. You have an inner area. So where I live in the Bay Area, you have San Francisco. That's what I would call like your hub or your, what's the word, an earthquake where it like starts right there. What's that?
Epicenter.
That's what I'm trying to say. Thank you. And then you have a second one in California in Silicon Valley. Those are these like two epicenters that you've got. Okay. But let's stick with San Francisco for now. People work in San Francisco. If you are the highest paying position in your company, you can afford to live in the same city that you work in. C-level executives, really skilled people, they can live in San Francisco. Or maybe if you own a house and like sold it, moved into a new house. Most people though can't afford to live there. So what happens is they get pushed out to where they can afford to live a house. Those would be called a secondary market. For us, that might be like Oakland, San Leandro, Hayward, Fremont, into like Berkeley, El Cerrito, Lafayette, those kind of areas. If you know the Bay Area, you know, those are all cities that are maybe 30 minutes away from San Francisco. You got to go any further than that, you get into what we call a tertiary market. Okay. Now you're probably commuting 45 minutes to an hour to get into San Francisco. But a lot of those markets out here, you're still getting into $700,000, $800,000 houses. Okay. In California, but the next market, like whatever the fancy word is for fourth after tertiary, I don't even know what that is, quadriceptuary or something.
Something like that, yeah.
That might be an area like Stockton, if you've ever heard of those phrases.
Oh.
Okay. The danger is when the market is high and houses are expensive, it's tempted to go all the way out to the Stocktons because that's where the houses are cheapest, right? But when you have a recession, imagine like San Francisco is the epicenter. That's where all the water is. The tide goes out and it pushes the water all the way out to Stockton. Okay. When there's a recession, it doesn't all evaporate at the same time. It shrinks back to the epicenter. People still have to live in a house. So they don't just say, I'm going to be homeless. They say, I'm going to let my Stockton house go because it went down in value. And I'm going to move into Walnut Creek, into the tertiary market or into the secondary market. Okay. Because there I can get the same house or a better house for the same money as the one I let go. Right. And those people, if they lost their house, they go up a step too. They move into San Francisco. So as a general rule, if you're buying after a recession, you can go into those third, fourth tier markets. Okay. Because they're only going to get better with time. You don't want to do that at the top of a market because you're putting yourself really extended. And when the water does suck back in, you're the first one who's left out there high and dry. So while everyone else may feel tempted to go buy those properties in those less desirable areas, that's actually the worst thing you could do. You really want to avoid it unless you get an incredible deal. You actually want to spend more money for the safety of being closer to the epicenter.
Right. Okay. That makes sense. All right. And then, that's actually really interesting because, I'm currently considering a quadriceps market at the moment from Chicago, at least. So
are there jobs near that market or are they all in Chicago?
So the jobs are all in Chicago. Yeah, pretty much.
That's what's scary. If that market had its own industry, people that worked there, that live there, you'd be safe. But if all the people that live there are all commuting to Chicago in 3 years, 4 years, if we have a recession, they're all going to move out and they're going to move closer to Chicago. And now you're having a hard time finding a tenant.
Gotcha. Okay. Got it. Yeah, that makes sense. Huh.
But some tertiary markets, they still have their own industry. Does that make sense? Like sometimes you have a tertiary market that has like a couple hospitals in that city, And as long as you buy it near the hospital and you have people that work at the hospital that can rent your property, then you're good to go.
I see. Okay. Oh, that's really good. Okay. Huh. All right. And outside of that, what would you recommend for people trying to now who are going out of state, who have never done it before? Should they do that as their first home or should they do that like?
Yeah. So you can do it out of state as your first home. I'm not as big of a fan of it. I personally think the best way to get started is to house hack. And I'm happy to talk about why that is and what house hacking is if you think that's a good idea.
Yeah. Just give a rundown and why you think it's benefits. There's like a few bullet points, right?
Yeah. So house hacking is when you combine living in a primary residence with renting out a property and making an investment property, and you kind of get the best of both worlds. So the whole reason that we use the Burr method to shorten it up is to get capital back out of the deal so you don't run out of money. Well, when you're house hacking, you get to use a primary residence loan. My clients are putting down anywhere between 3 to 5%, right? And so you don't need to get your money back out of the deal because you're not putting that much money into the deal, first off, okay? The second part would be you get a better interest rate on your loan because it's a primary residence and you get a 30-year fixed rate. You don't have to worry about going to a portfolio lender, trying to get an adjustable rate mortgage or paying the higher rate. And you don't have to put the 20 to 25% down that you have to on rental property. That's what makes the Burr method powerful is the traditional method of buying a rental. You got to put down so much freaking cash. You can't buy the next one. Well, house hacking, you avoid that. The next thing a lot of people miss, and I want you guys to pay attention. If you have 50 grand, okay, and you want to go invest it and you get a 12% return, that's a really good return. You're going to make $500 a month. So let's say you go out to Chicago where Nelson is and you buy a property, you buy a duplex, you get $500 a month in cash flow. You're feeling great. You got a 12% return. If you take that same 50 grand and you buy a house hack where you already live, which is probably a solid market because you make good money. That's how you have $50,000. And your mortgage was $2,500, but now you only have to spend $700 or $800. Okay. That would be, help me with the math here, like 1,700 or so?
Yeah, 1,700.
Okay. You're making 17, well, let's see, what, 2,500 you're spending, let's just say you're paying 1,000. So you're making $1,500. That's all that you have to come, that's what you're making in rent. Okay. Right. If you were renting, it was 2,500. Instead, you've bought a house and you're only coming out of pocket 1,000 because you're renting it for 1,500. You've reduced your expenses by 1,500. That is the same net out of your balance sheet as the 500 a month you make as a rental property. Okay. So you got 1500 a month to house hack, 500 a month for that same money on a good return. It might be more like 300 a month because 12% is pretty hard to get right now, which means you're getting three times as much money to house hack. That's a 36% return on that 50 grand if you house hack, right? And you're paying off a principal that's much higher because you borrowed money to buy it. So if you throw that into it, it starts to go up even more. And now you're getting a tax deduction. You're getting to write off the interest on your mortgage payment that you weren't getting when you rented. Now you're getting up into 50, 55% return on your money. And that's year one. What do you think happens next year when the rent goes from 1500 to 1700? Okay. Now you're at like a 60% return and the rent was going to go up on you at your apartment from 2,500 to 2,700. That's another 200 that you just saved. Now you're getting into 62, 65% return on your money. And every year it gets sweeter. Okay. The fact that rents keep going up and housing prices keep going up makes house hacking such a no-brainer. It's like, it's replaced Burr as what I think is the most powerful wealth building strategy that there is. I'm not like I'm saying Burr's bad, okay? House hacking is just so much better right now. So what I tell people, the very best strategy you can have is to house hack a new house every year. That is a freebie. You almost can't get a bad deal if you house hack and you put a little bit of money down and you buy in a good area where rents go up. In addition to that, let's talk about buying out of state. Let's talk about Burr. Let's talk about flipping. Let's talk about other stuff, but always minimum house hack one house every single year for 10 years. It's the best return you're going to get.
I see.
Nelson, I know you said you're a data scientist. You're over there smiling as we go into all these numbers.
Yeah. Oh, you know, I'm just like, people like talk numbers because then it makes much more sense. I think a lot of people in this group are also very technical. The Bay Area was New York. They're all like finance or tech. So you get in the numbers, people were like, oh yeah, this man speaks my language.
Do you think any of them are skeptical? Because I said a 65% ROI and that just sounds like a scam.
Oh yeah, it definitely does. But I've also seen my numbers and like I'm house hacking right now, like a quadplex, and like it makes sense. I'm looking at the next quadplex, you know.
The reason it's not a scam is because when you're looking to buy a property, you have to get a pure return on your cash. Okay. When you house hack, it's like you get to cheat because you get to take your housing allowance, what you had to spend, and hack off a huge freaking piece of it. Okay. And if you include that in your numbers, it makes your ROI super big. If I go buy a house for, you know, some out of state place and I get a 12% return, which I crushed it, I still got to spend $2,500 a month for my rent. It hurts all the time, right? House hacking kills like two birds with one stone and lets me take advantage of all the benefits of homeownership, low down payment, better interest rate, mortgage interest deduction, increasing rents on what I charge, not having to pay increasing rents from when I was renting. And all of that combines together to make this super sweet deal.
Okay. Yeah. I love it. Okay. So then on the next, you actually mentioning it, you also wrote the book on Burr. So I know Brandon was the one who invented the term, but why did you decide to write the book on it? And if you think it's not as good nowadays, does that mean you would like warn against it? Because I know for a lot of properties, when you burr out nowadays, when you buy and refinance out, you technically don't cash flow as well as you could holding on to the properties. It might even be better to just flip it instead.
Okay, so there's a few things. Let's talk about, should you flip or should you hold? But talk about how the current industry has changed, what to expect on the ARV. And let's talk about, is Burr still good? We'll start with that one. Yes, Burr is still just as good as it ever was. Okay. What makes Burr less powerful than house hacking is that rents keep going up so much right now. As the economy is heating up, landlords are increasing what they charge in rent by a lot. And a lot of that has to do with the money that the government is putting into the economy. The stimulus package, if you guys haven't looked at that because you've heard everybody on the news saying the sky is falling, COVID-19 is going to destroy the earth. Go look at the money that the government has put into the economy. For lack of a better phrase, our economy was ready to like needed a kind of a nap. Okay. It's been going really hard for a really long time. It needed to slow down a little bit. And we just pumped a bunch of methamphetamine right into it. Like, nope, get up and start running again. Okay. You're not going to see a slowdown with that much money. Now you're going to see inflation. You're going to see like all that money has to find a home. You're going to see wages go up in areas they probably shouldn't because venture capitalists have to go put that money. A lot of it goes into tech. That's a long thing to get into right now, but you're not going to see a slowdown when there's been that much money put into it. Now, certain industries, sure. Right? Like certain parts of your body maybe aren't affected by methamphetamines. Like the guys who are working in the coal mine, they're probably not going to be affected by it. You might see a slowdown in certain parts of the country, but overall, you're going to see things that actually heat up a lot more. What that means, short answer, rents are going to keep going up. Okay. As rents keep going up, even as you're investing in real estate, it gets harder and harder to actually stay ahead because you added $600 a month of cash flow to your portfolio, but you went up $300 a month on your rent, right? It's like really, really hard to get ahead. If you can get out of having your rent increase and lock it in and everyone else's rent keeps going up, that delta is how much more money you made every year. And if you can start another cycle of that with a new house hack all the time, you keep winning. Now, Burr is still a powerful way to invest wealth, but I don't look at it so much like a real estate investing strategy as I look at it as like a business philosophy. It's the philosophy that says buy an asset that's struggling, improve it, and then take your capital out of it to go put into the next thing. You can burr a restaurant. You can burr a tech company. You can burr an AutoZone store. Burr works on anything, right? Some guy owns a 7-Eleven and his net operating income is very low because he doesn't run it very well. And you go in there and buy it at a low price because the NOI is really low. You clean it up. You get rid of the employee that was stealing money. You track your inventory better. You run some sales. Now, all of a sudden, you're making twice as much money. You go get an SBA loan and you refinance your 7-Eleven and get cash back and you look for the next one. It's the same thing we're doing with houses right now. So if you can find a really good deal, you can fix it up and then you can refinance it, Burr still works. It's just harder because there's so many other investors trying to find that same deal. And there's so many other people that are looking to do the same thing that when I was first doing it, they were everywhere. It was just ugly houses all over the place and I could go snag them. And it's just getting a little bit harder. So I'm not saying Burr doesn't work. Burr will still work. It is still so much better than just the traditional method. And that's another thing, Nelson, I'm glad you brought up. A lot of people say, if I can't get out 100% of my money, Burr didn't work. Not true at all. You don't compare Burr to 100% of your money out. You compare Burr to the traditional method. I'm going to buy a rental. Okay. Do I want to leave 10 grand in that deal or do I want to leave 45 grand in that deal? right? Maybe the 10 grand doesn't cash flow quite as good, but when interest rates are 4% on a rental property, borrowing more money doesn't hurt your cash flow nearly as much as you would think. Having that extra $35,000 in the bank so that if your tenant loses their job because of COVID-19 and you need to pay something, or the next deal comes along, or your property does lose value, having that 35 grand in the bank is so much smarter than having it in equity in the property where you can't use it.
That makes sense. And then, so you're saying earlier too, how do you decide then, do I hold on to this property or do I just, you know, flip it?
That's a really good question too. So the benefit of this find a distressed deal, fix it up and make it worth more is that you don't have to refinance it and you don't have to sell it. It's the same. Burr and flipping are not completely independent investing strategies, okay? They're like a tree that runs the very same trunk until the very top and then they split. Okay. So you only have to change 10% of the process if you can burr a house or if you can flip a house. And the only thing you got to figure out if you're going to keep it versus sell it is, if I keep it, what will my ROI on my equity be? Okay. So if I'm going to leave 10 grand in this deal and it's going to cash flow $200 a month, that's a 24% return on my money. It's a pretty good deal. I should probably burr that. Okay. If I'm going to have to leave 60 grand in the deal and it's only going to cash flow $200, that's like a 3 or 4% return on my money. I'm going to flip it, right? It becomes very simple. You find a common metric and make it an apples to apples understanding. And the metric is return on equity. The minute you can calculate for the money I'm leaving in the deal, what is my annualized return? It becomes very quick. If I should flip it and put it in the next one, or if I should refinance it, leave a little bit in and use the money for the next deal.
That makes sense. Okay. All right. So, wow, this is a lot of good stuff. Hold on. I'm taking a lot of notes here. So
I talk fast. That's not your fault.
Yeah, I got to jot all this down. Smart people talk fast. That's my experience. So
thank you for that.
Not that southern drawl that I've
got. When I get told I talk too fast, I should interpret that as, oh, you're not very smart.
No, please. You're embarrassing me here. Okay. So, all right. And I'm glad we got like the two big ones out of the way. Now let's get to the big question everyone's talking about, coronavirus. I know you said it's heating up, but how has your strategy changed since it started in terms of investing, or at least what you'd recommend for people?
So the point I make in long distance real estate investing, one of the points is that you pick your market wisely. And you largely pick it based on how many 1% properties are there if you're looking for rentals. If you're looking for flips, the day on market. You want a low day on market to find flips. You actually kind of want a high day on market to find rentals because that means less competition. You also look at economic factors. And the most important one in that book that I talked about was the diversity of employment. Okay. The one city that you lost money in investing in America in the last 20 years was Detroit. Because all of the jobs came from the auto industry. And when that one leg that the whole table was resting on went out, the whole thing went out. What we're starting to see now is that diversity of employment is very important with where you invest. Because the one Achilles heel in all of real estate investing is that you got to have a tenant. When you're buying a rental property, you're buying a business, you're buying a 7-Eleven. But your business earns revenue in one way. It just sells Slurpees. It doesn't sell all that other stuff, okay? So if your Slurpee machine breaks, you'd make zero revenue. If you don't have a tenant, you can't make money in real estate. Or if you have a tenant, but your tenant's not paying. So you have to be thinking now when you're trying to decide, where do I want to invest? It's just one more argument for why, well, I want to invest in my own backyard stops making sense. What if in your backyard, everybody works on an assembly line and they are not allowed to go to work? What if your backyard is a tourist area where the only jobs are depend on people flying in and doing something? And now that that's been shut down, you lose those jobs. I'm looking a whole lot more at this point into what is the industry where I'm looking to invest in, right? Is there an Amazon supercenter in that area? I feel really good about that at this point, okay? Like buying all around these Amazon stores. I don't think Amazon's going anywhere. I think that's a pretty safe bet for the next couple of years. I think that the worse America gets, the more Amazon's gonna do well. That's becoming like your solid play, right? At one point it was like the riskiest thing. And now that's like, it's like your, what used to be like an oil company or something like that.
That was what Walmart was during 2008-2009, right? When people would follow Walmart to—
There you go. That's exactly right. So it's not enough to just think about where's the best price. You got to look at the big picture and say, where's the most secure jobs? Because secure jobs means secure rent. Secure rent means a secure investment because that's the only way you can get revenue in. find that market. Once you found it, then go look for the deal that you want.
Hmm. Gotcha. Okay. And yeah. Okay. Yeah. That's those are pretty good points. All right. So now I think we're just going to finish up. I have some Q&A questions.
Do it.
If you have, thank you again for your time. I know this is it's a Sunday night. I probably should time this better. Like what time do you usually think people like it would be better? Cause like when I look at the group, like insights, it's like this Sunday night is apparently the most popular. I don't know why. So that's why I've been like scheduling them around this time. But
I think Sunday night's a good night. Part of the problem is though, if you have East Coast people versus West Coast people, if you get any later than 5, it gets hard for the East Coast people to make it. And if you get any earlier, then they're all at like either at work or still working in the day.
Yeah. And it's also like, if it's Sunday though, you know, you want to be outside. You want like some sunlight. So like, it's better. So
luckily I got that in before we did this. I just got back from a run.
Yeah. The weather's been super good here. I've just been so surprised because, you know, Chicago, even during the summer, you're like, all right, when's the polar vortex going to hit? Cause it just changes day to day. Okay. So somebody asked on a BP episode, you talked about potentially turning a split level into 2 units. They have a property right now in that exact situation and have a basement with its own entrance, but can't figure out how to properly split the utilities between the basement tenant and the upstairs tenant. The breaker panel is also located in the basement and the upstairs tenant would have to come downstairs to reset it if needed. How would you go about the scenario? I guess the main thing is like, what kind of contractor probably I'm assuming you'd suggest, but like if you're trying to split into a multifamily, what would you recommend how somebody goes about doing that?
Those are good questions. And I come across this all the time working as an agent when we're trying to find houses for our clients. This comes up a lot. First thing is you get an estimate from an electrician what it would cost to move that circuit breaker panel to the exterior. That's your easiest thing. The next would be in the meantime, when whoever your downstairs tenant is you have to tell them, hey, you're going to have to flip that circuit breaker when the upstairs tenant needs you to. They're going to send you a text. There may be a point when you're not home if that breaker does flip. Like, is there anything you're going to be keeping in your unit that you wouldn't be comfortable with having here if the guy had to come in from upstairs and flip that panel or something like that? That's your short-term solution. And that's how most people kind of work that out. What was another thing that they had mentioned about the split level problem?
One is how do they split the utilities?
There you go.
It just like, besides electricity, like what else would they need to set?
So when that happens, what you usually have to do is you have to pay the utilities as a landlord, and then you have to charge it back to the tenants. There's a few ways you can do it. The easiest for you is just to charge more rent, but they like that the least. So that's usually not your best bet. The next bet would be you look at the utilities and they split them in half or something like that. Then they're upset because they say, why do I have to? And if they pay their rent, but not their utilities, you can't really evict them. It becomes a lot harder to do that. So what I like to do is it's a system called RUBS. If you guys Google RUBS, I can't remember what the acronym stands for. Do you know, Nelson?
Yeah, it was like, I can't remember the R, but it's something about utility billing system.
Whatever the R is in that. So what you do is you basically say each unit has X amount of people living in it. You take the two bills together, you divide it by how many people there are total. You come up with a percentage of what the people in unit A are versus unit B, and you split the utility bill up. You take like an average and you charge that back to both sides. So landlords like that because if the tenant is being billed back for their own utilities, they're likely to use less. That's better than having to charge them more on rent because then they just use up all your utilities and you don't get it. But you got to tell them that up front. You have to say, hey, one of the benefits of living here is that I pay the utilities and this is how I'm going to bill it back to you. But you have to understand that you're sharing it with another person. So you guys kind of have to work together here.
So one question too about that is I actually am encountering this and I'm trying to implement RUBS, but a lot of companies are like, we don't do anything under 20 units. So like, is it possible to do RUBS on something that's only like a duplex?
I think what you're referring to is when they install separate meters, right?
Submetering? Oh.
Yeah.
No, this was actually just for RUBS, but maybe I'm...
Well, RUBS, you do yourself.
Oh.
The landlord would come up with that formula and you would bill them back.
Okay.
It might be reduced utility billing system or something like that. That might be the R. Somebody in your group's going to come up with it and be like, David,
podcast.
You should know that.
Yeah, I'll check that later. Okay, so when investing at a distance, How are you making sure the contractor isn't adding on more work or being responsible for damages they caused? For example, say like you have like a floor joist that's rotten when you remove the subfloor. Do you have someone on your team verify every time they get like uncovered?
Okay, so first off, that's not a long distance problem. That's a rehab problem, right? And if you interpret it like it's a long distance problem, you'll look at it differently. Every single rehab has that happen in it. Second off, you could always tell the contractor, no, don't do it, right? So don't look at it like they're adding on work. I look at it like they are introducing a new option to me and they're letting me make the decision for myself if I want to fix it. But a floor joist you would want to replace. If you're worried that the contractor is making it up, have them make you a video. Be like, hey, can you just start a video, walk through the house, walk right up to where the floor joist is and put the phone really close so that you don't have to worry about them sending you the picture of a different property or something like that. That alone is enough that they're probably not going to be lying about it. If you're super paranoid, yeah, you just get your property manager or an agent or a friend or a Bigger Pockets member or a Task Rabbit guy, like whoever it is you find and be like, can you go take me a picture of what this thing looks like? I've never seen it have to become that serious because once a contractor knows that you're going to ask them for proof, they're not very likely to make something up.
Makes sense. Okay. Have you ever encountered something like that? Like all your long distance stuff, somebody trying to like squeeze a little more out of you?
No, it's hardly ever that they're trying to squeeze more out of me. It's way more that the jobs always go longer than what they thought they were going to do. And there's a part of, so here's something we'll just help people. You have to understand when you're dealing with a contractor, you're dealing with a human that is usually really good at fixing things and building things and really terrible at everything else. So when I hear people complain about the customer service or the organization, I'm like, yeah, like that's not what they do. They're not ever going to be good at that. It's like, you hear the same thing people complain about agents. He didn't know how to run numbers. He didn't know how to find out this stuff. I'm like, that's because agents make money being friendly. Right. That's why you picked them. Cause they look like they shake hands and kiss babies and you just pick the nicest one. Right.
I would let you hold my baby. Yeah,
what's that?
I would let you hold my baby. It's totally
yeah. I'm super nice. Right. That's something to think about when you're trying to do this is if your expectations are not in line with the skill set of the person you're hiring, you're always disappointed. If you get too disappointed, you'll quit. And if you quit, you'll lose out on the 30 years of appreciation and paying down a mortgage of rent building and or rent rental investment, and you'll lose. So don't rely on them to do something they're not good at. If he tells me 8 weeks, what I hear is if nothing goes wrong, if every one of his guys shows up, if we don't find anything in the deal we weren't expecting, if we don't get tagged and they have to go get permits, the best case scenario is 8 or 9 weeks. So I'm on planning for like 12 to 14 weeks. And then when he's done in 10 or 11, I'm not upset. The people who are like, he said it would be 10 weeks and it's not 10 weeks. In their job, that doesn't fly. In their world, you don't get to do that. But in the contracting world, like they don't care. It just in their head, like, well, what do you want me to do? The floor joist is bad. That's how it goes. And so it's better to release that understanding that it should be a certain way and just accept the way that it is so that you don't get too discouraged.
Got it. Okay. I have the last few questions. Sorry, running a little
over. Yeah, go ahead.
All right. So what would you let your agent's family be the contractor? Or the agent also be the property manager? How do you deal with a conflict of interest with somebody who's like trying to buy the
property? It's not even, don't even look at it like conflict of interest, okay? Look at it like competency. Have you ever, Nelson, ate at one of those Chinese restaurants that also does taxes and also does dry cleaning?
Yes. Oh, yeah.
Did you get great food or great tax advice?
That was me, actually. I was the accountant and I was a cash register. It was a good time growing up.
There you go, right? It's not like it's a terrible business model, but it typically isn't a model that like elicits a high level of excellence when you're doing that, okay? When I hear someone that says I'm an agent and I'm a property manager, I typically hear I'm not super great at either one, okay? So I don't really care about the conflict of interest. I care about the fact that they're probably not going to be good at what they're doing. When I get an agent, I want an agent that sells a lot of houses and that knows a lot of people, right? I can run numbers. I can come up with the plan for what I want to do. I need their resources. Do you have a contractor? Do you have a roof person? Do you have someone we can talk to when my loan falls apart? And I want their experience. They can go and give me a really good idea what the ARV is going to be. Or they know when they tell me this is what you got to pay, I believe them because they sell a ton of houses and they don't want to waste their time. when I look for a property manager, I want a person with great systems, great models, and a great understanding of that market. When they tell me, David, I can rent that thing all day for $1,100, I can believe them. Okay. I don't want the one that's like, oh, let's go 1300 and see what happens, because that means I don't know. I don't do this very often and I'm not able to give you good advice. So I don't worry nearly as much about conflict of interest. I just want a very high level of competency.
Got it. And then when did you hit 10 mortgages? Did you eventually move into commercial after that? Or how do you pivot out of, you know, small residential? And then I guess their final question was pretty much, what are your current goals? Are you still buying long distance rentals? Well, obviously you're focusing, actually, yeah, this would be a good time to talk about your company, right? In your mastermind group.
Yeah, so my current goals right now is to become the top real estate agent in the Bay Area, and or really Northern California, because we're in Sacramento too. Not many agents are good. It is very hard to find a good one. I want everyone to experience the benefits of homeownership. So I've kind of pivoted away from just buying a whole bunch of rentals into building up a team of people and turning that business somewhat passive so I can generate more income to buy into different asset classes. There's still deals out there, but they're so much harder to find than before that I'd rather focus on getting other people deals than I would like just try to get my own. There's another problem. Once you get so many single family houses, that the juice stops being worth the squeeze. Like that first couple hundred bucks of cash flow you get, like, you know, when you, your first four houses and they all cash flow $300, you get you to 1200. It's freaking huge. It like, it changes your life, right? But once you've got like a certain amount of money coming in, you just see like, this is another headache that I'm taking on. I don't need $300 a month that bad. Okay. So at a certain point, you see diminishing returns getting into single family and you have to pivot into a multifamily, which is why you rarely ever hear of investors with 200 single family homes. The multifamily space is stupid frothy. Everybody's in there. There's just so much money and it needs to find a home. I don't want to go try to buy in multifamily. I'm mostly just buying money, setting it aside, focusing on building businesses and waiting to see when multifamily changes, because then I can go start 1031ing single family assets into multi. I like to look at a synergistic approach to everything I do. So I help clients buy houses. Now I started a mortgage business. So now we can do loans for our own clients. Now we can get them a better interest rate because we don't have to make as much on the loan because we're making more on the real estate thing. Now I have a world I can take people that are interested in real estate and plug them into these two worlds. They interact super good. Eventually what I want is to take my houses, 1031 them into multifamily apartments, take the money from the multifamilies and put down payments on new single family houses every single month. So my single family base bought me multifamily. My multifamily properties buy me single family. I wait for those to appreciate and pay down. I 1031 into a new multifamily and I have both of them kind of working together. That way of thinking is what I really spend more of my time focusing on. Like, okay, this is my goal. How do I work backwards to make that happen? What skills do I need? What education do I need? What resources do I need? What people do I need? And so I started the David Green Team Mastermind, where I have people that come to me that say, David, I want to earn more money at my job. I want to invest better. I want to be more successful. I want a promotion. I want whatever. And I teach that group the stuff we're talking about right now. Here's what I did to get it. This is how I became, I went from nobody to host of the Bigger Pockets podcast. The two books I wrote became bestsellers right away. This is how I started writing for Forbes. This is how I got on TV. This is how I got on House Hunters or whatever. This is how I get on CNN. There's actually a formula to doing that. There's a strategy that you put in place that gets you into that position. And most people are so much closer than what they think. Like what you think is you're so far away. You're this close. It's a few changes that have to be made. So that's what I teach the members. I go, hey, here's what I'm doing in my life. Here's the challenges I'm facing. Here's how I'm confronting them. Let's talk with them about what their business is or their goals and how they can apply the concepts. So the books I'm reading that I really like, I say, here's the concept, here's how we would apply it in these situations. So at most, I remember what the struggle was like when I was in your guys' position and I was just working massive hours, saving money, so desperate for someone to be like, just give me a hand, show me what I'm supposed to do. I remember how frustrating it was. And that's why I haven't really evolved into like the big shot guy. I still drive a Camry. I still wear t-shirts, right? I like to deal with the W-2 worker who's trying to get out of the rat race. I'm not wanting to go to the Catalina wine mixer and drink eat caviar and drink champagne and rub elbows with like the guys. I'm in some of those circles, but I'm not as comfortable there. I'm much more into like, you're the boots on the ground person. Let's help you GetApp. And so that's why most of what my efforts are into are this mastermind or a mortgage company or a real estate team. It's not me trying to compete with Ty Lopez and see like who can get the most girls in our Ferrari on Instagram.
Got it. Okay. Yeah. And then how do people get in contact with you?
If you want to learn about the mastermind, you can go to davidgreenteammastermind.com. davidgreenmastermind.com. There's a E at the end. If you guys want, I'm on Instagram at davidgreen24. You can message me on there. I try to keep up with those messages the most, or Facebook Messenger, davidgreen24. And then my email, if you have questions about work-related things, like you want me to help you find a house or you live in California, you need a loan, you want a house, davidgreen@kw is the best way. But if people just want like regular advice, don't answer, don't go to that email because other people check it too. And they'll probably see that, oh, this isn't a work thing and I'll never see your message. So for those kind of questions, hit me up on Instagram or check out the mastermind.
All right, perfect. Thank you for your time. I really appreciate this. One more time, third time's a charm, I think. I hope you have a good rest of your Sunday, and I'll send everyone your way. Thank you again.
You did a great job, Nelson. You're good at this, man. Keep it up.
I'm just trying to help people out here too, you know? So that's awesome. Kind of the plan. Thank you.
All right, guys. Have a great week.
Thank you. Bye.